20, 30 years, and no one set aside a dime to deal with health care for the citizens. But the reality is, in a bankruptcy, there are two types of creditors. There are secured and there are unsecured. And what you must do is treat people in their classes, secured and unsecured, equally. We have said we're not going to impair the secured class, the DWSD bonds and some others. We've said we will treat everyone in the unsecured class equally because that's what's required under the law. How that breaks out is a function of the math, but it's the math. It's just the way it is.
Bankole,
hey, Bankole.
Kevin, let's put aside the creditors.
Another 48% of that, or almost 80%, okay, are fixed costs for police, fire, EMS, right? So we have approximately 20% that we use for everything else, every pothole, every snowplow, every garbage, everything else is about $200 million. Of that $11 to $12 billion of unsecured debt, if we took that $200 million and did nothing else in the city, another pothole, another snow doesn't get plowed, no garbage gets picked, did everything else within the city, it would take us over 50 years to pay that debt. So there's no way home from that equation. There's no amount of revenue that we could generate to try to address it. So we have to treat it in this fashion in bankruptcy, which is what's normal.
This gentleman over here.
Yes, sir. That's a very good question. The $2 billion note that we're proposing for unsecured was the only mechanism we could come up with to offer the unsecured creditors some form of recovery given the realities of our budget situation. The Merrill Lynch UBS settlement, they're secured creditors. They had liens on both our casino revenue as well as the $40 million payment that I defaulted on June 14th. As secured creditors, to impair their interests, we had to make an adjustment. But more important than that, they agreed to release their liens. They have agreed to not seek to recover against their insurer. They have agreed to allow us access of $180 million of annual revenue, which if you look at the plan, proposal we put out on June 14th, requires cash flow of at least that much to address the $125 million a year we want to use for blight remediation, for health, safety, and welfare concerns over the next 10 years. We would have no plan. We would have no course, no plan of adjustment without that revenue. In addition to them releasing their liens, they agreed to give us a discount on the swap obligation that we had, which was somewhere in the neighborhood of $350 million, which was signed years and years ago. The total value of that resolution to the city is somewhere in the neighborhood of $75 to $80 million plus the $180 million we get for a secured party agreeing to give up their security interest. That's why we did that deal. I'd be happy to listen to any other plan someone can come up with given the restraints that we're working under. The reality is with the $12 billion in unsecured debt, there's precious little we can do.
Allison.
Well, bankruptcy is, you know, as I've said time and again, bankruptcy is a tool in our toolbox to get at the goals that we want to achieve and the proposal that we made on June 14th. I think one, in direct response, Allison, to your question, one, it gives us breathing room. You know, as you know, we were being sued almost on a weekly basis, and that's the very thing I had asked, I had pleaded for not to happen. I had asked to have a consensual resolution. For whatever reason, people decided that's not what they wanted to do. Fair enough. People are entitled to act in their own interests. Number two, it gives us a forum, as the governor just said, to bring all parties in. A significant percentage of parties that we have to speak to are unrepresented, the retirees. What you will see in the papers that we're filing is a request by the court to appoint, we are moving to appoint a retiree committee. So we will have someone to speak to in all fairness, in an abundance of fairness. And I recognize some practitioners will say, that's not a smart move. You're asking to appoint an opponent in your case. But we think that's what's fair, and we're going to try to do this in a fair way. In addition, in freeing up the cash flow, it allows us to focus on the key issue that the governor has reiterated again and again, the health, safety, and welfare of 700,000 citizens in the city of Detroit. Yes, there are 9,700 employees and there are 19,700, 20,000 retirees, but there are 700 citizens who don't deserve a 55-minute response time, who don't deserve endemic blight and crime, who don't deserve no hope and future and just continue debt over debt and borrowing. So we have to do this in some fashion, and bankruptcy will allow us to achieve that in some way.
What shocked you most when you looked through the books? Was there a particular element of the finances that really stunned you?
I think the depth and some of the practices deferring pension obligation years after. What shocked me wasn't the numbers, because they're, you can put zeros behind digits and create more numbers. What shocked me was the tolerance for this behavior for decades. This has been going on for a very long time, and to say the least, it is at best unorthodox in terms of how these things were going. Frankly, I'm surprised that I know a lot of people outraged at my appointment, my take. I wish there had been a lot more outrage over the past 10, 20 years. Yes. Mm-hmm. Casino revenue. The casino revenue comes in at approximately $180 million, and if we defaulted, that would have been their security interest. We would not have had access to that cash flow. There's technical as far as signature pages, whether or not they've been exchanged. There's some other documents we have to follow up on, but we have that agreement in principle, and it's dialed in.
What was the straw that
broke
the camel's back on this? Was it the pension board filing?
No. No, the fact that we're running out of time. I've got 15 months left on my tenure. I promised the governor that we were going to try to get this done within the time frames provided by the statute. There's a lot of work to be done here, even within that 15 months. We got three work streams. We have to deal with the creditor interest, we have to deal with the labor interest, and we have to deal with operations for the city. The statute imposes certain obligations on me on the back end. I've got to have a two-year budget. I've got to look at charter reform, perhaps. There are issues regarding investigations and appointments and other contracts in the ordinary course. There's a lot of work to be done here in 15 months. We're dealing with 60 years of deferred maintenance in 18 months. I can't afford to spend time running in place again and again and again to address the very issues I'm here supposed to be doing.
Mr. Orr, are you going to open
Kirk
the
over here
from
hey,
into the pension obligations?
Please.
Kirk,
we're taking our turns, please.
I'm sorry, Kirk, please. Thank you. That's a good question. What we've said to the vendors is we're going to work in the ordinary course. There may be a glitch in some checks that were sent out last week that we're going to have a hotline that they can call so that those checks can be addressed and their issues. But generally speaking, especially going forward, let's talk about the filing yesterday. Going forward in the ordinary course is business as usual. We will pay our bills. In fact, we may end up paying our bills a little bit quicker than usual. Some of the other bills that came in before we filed, we're going to try to pay the majority of those. 80%, I think, are below $5,000 or so, and we're going to pay those, especially those that are critical vendors related to health, safety, and welfare, police, and fire. We're going to take care of those. Those that may get caught in the gap or may have questions, we're going to have a hotline they can call to decide how we're going to address those issues. But frankly, we're going to try to pay our bills on time for once.
You talk about the urgency and the need to get things moving. There seems to be considerable debate about how long the bankruptcy process will take. Mm-hmm. How confident are you that this can be something that takes months, maybe a year, rather than something that goes on for years?
Well, I think the issues that we have to address regarding the city's insolvency and the magnitude, and what we tried to do in the first 90 days was to put all that information out there so we wouldn't be debating the extent of the debt, what we have to address. And we seem to have had some success with that, because nobody's saying the city's not insolvent or it's not $18 billion. Everybody agrees with that. Secondly, we will have an eligibility fight, I suspect, in the court, and that's why we filed today with our papers a request by the judge who has yet to be appointed, a scheduling process so that we can bring some order to the process. So people who have objections will make them and we'll respond, and there'll be that determination. Once we get by that, frankly, because there are two impaired classes, two classes, one is unimpaired and one is going to be impaired. The secured classes are going to be unimpaired, so we put them to the side, and that's you know, mostly bond debt related to water. But for the unsecured, it's a large number, but it's a finite world. And the issue that we propose is give them some level of recovery will be debated, but as far as what we can do based upon the cash flows that the city has, there's not a whole lot of room for movement. It's not like we're going to go from being able to create a $2 billion note to creating a $10 billion note. We don't have the cash flow to service that even if we could. Okay, so it's going to be finite, and that's why I'm highly confident we can do this within the time that I have left during my tenure. Of course, the best laid plans can go awry once the first shot is fired, but we're going to try to keep to that timetable.
All right, I apologize. We're almost running out of time, so we're going to do two last questions. This
Sorry.
Jim Kirchner, Channel 7, and then Sarah Swick from Michigan Radio. And then He's we'll have to wrap it up, but they'll be available.
Oh, Jim?
Yeah.
Okay. Hey, Jim.
I wouldn't say it's over the question of the judge, because they're very competent bankruptcy judges. And we have confidence that we're going to get a good judge. So the biggest fear is this whole process is making sure that we can have a great dialogue with the citizens of Detroit, in my view. Because it's just, much as you said, bankruptcy is a term that none of us ever wanted to get to this point. And one of the first things I was concerned about are people going to think the police aren't going to come anymore, or something's going to stop. And that's why we really wanted to have this, to reassure the citizens of Detroit, normal operations continue. People will be paid. People can do services. But I also want to emphasize, I don't view this as a terrible answer in the sense that now's our opportunity to stop 60 years of decline. This is fundamental. Has anyone liked the Detroit of 5 years ago, of 10 years ago, of 15 years ago? How long has this gone on and people had not stopped to say, stop kicking the can down the road and do something? We are doing something. This is the forum. This is the place to do it in. This is the place to deal with the debt question. This is the place to put a plan for improved services for the citizens. There are tremendously good things going on in Detroit outside of city government. Let's support those by resolving city government and getting on a positive path. So when you ask the worst case, I don't dwell on that. There's a lot of hard work, difficult work to do. That work will get done. And we will come out with a stronger, better Detroit and a format to grow the city, because the citizens of this, not only the city, but the state deserve it. And we're going to give them good service.
All right, and Sarah's our closer. And then with that, we'll get our TV folks so we can get back there. So Sarah, your last question, please.
Yeah, well, the doctrine of Chapter 9 is skewed that way, but it's really not towards the city. It's towards the health, safety, and welfare of the citizens, because that's how it should be. You know, does anybody think it's okay to have 40-year-old trees growing through the roofs of dilapidated houses? Does anybody think our children should walk through the streets dark home from school at night in October? Does anybody think that they should call the police and not be able to come on time because they're already out on calls? No. So the doctrine of Chapter 9 is designed to address those very questions. I recognize it's a lever. Even under that admonition, we are trying very hard to be fair. We are asking ourselves for a process by judges. Bankruptcy judges handle everything from stores to shipping companies. I mean, they're remarkably competent in this regard. But to manage this process and also have everyone represented, including retirees, who we ask on June 14th, we ask some of the labor organizations, will you represent retirees? And some of them said, no, we won't. So we're going to ask for that representation. We will be fair even under the guise of Chapter 9 and the doctrine that it provides for the benefit of the city.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Orr.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.